Hi, I'm Blair, Head of Engineering here at HeatMaster. Today we're going to be looking at a topic that is the cornerstone of our high efficiency furnaces, gasification, a topic that's not always communicated clearly, not always understood by consumers and professionals alike, but we're going to dive into it in four levels today. We're going to start with the basic fundamentals and we're going to work our way up to the advanced complexities of gasification. Our goal is to leave you with a deeper understanding of gasification and how it benefits you when heating with wood. Cale, it's great to have you here. Thanks for coming and being willing to chat with us a bit about gasification. What do you notice when you're maybe making lunch? Do you like to eat Kraft dinner, macaroni?
My dad usually makes it.
Yeah, dad's good at making macaroni?
Yeah.
Very good. Does he do it over the fire, or does he do it on a
stove?
On the stove, yeah. So he'll take some water and he'll put it in a pot, right?
Yeah.
And what does he do with that water?
He boils it.
He boils it. And when you do that with wood, it's almost the same. Did you know that you can heat up wood and it will make smoke as well, right? Campfires. When you have a campfire when you're camping, what do you notice coming off of the wood that's maybe in your fire pit? What do you see?
It's smoking.
Yeah, it's smoking. And what do you notice when it gets hot? Say after you've kindled the fire and it's slowly gotten hotter and hotter and it's burning more. What do you see coming up off the logs?
The fire.
The fire, the flames, right? And that's essentially very similar to what's happening when you heat up water and you get steam, and now you're heating up wood and you're getting smoke and you're getting flames, right? And that's the first steps in gasification. And a fire outside in a campfire pit is a little different process than what we use in our wood furnaces, but it's right along the same steps. You can heat up wood, you get the gases, you get the flame, and that's the first steps of gasification. Well, Frank, thanks for coming.
Blair.
Pleasure to chat with you about gasification today. What areas of gasification do you understand? How have you experienced it in the industry with wood boilers, maybe in other industries?
Mostly in the boiler industries.
Yeah.
So just trying to use up that extra fuel to get the best efficiency,
mm-hmm.
most usage out of your wood.
Yeah. Yeah.
As opposed to, let's say, your conventional just wood boiler.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Can you think of other examples where there's a portion of the gasification process being used?
Well, I suppose in a campfire, you'd have no potential for gasification because it's all just goes into the atmosphere.
Yeah, it is going into the atmosphere. It's essentially a portion of the gasification process has happened. Your paralysis, you're driving the energy, the gases out of the wood, but they're not being used to the greatest of their potential. We're adding heat to the fuel, we're driving out the gases, and those gases are combusting and being in a very oxygen-rich environment, as a campfire would be, we're not gasifying as efficiently as we would in a very controlled environment, such as of the firebox or the combustion chamber of a wood furnace.
So you would still have more wasted fuel in your ash, so to speak, and let's say just a campfire as opposed to a boiler.
Exactly. Yeah, wasted fuel in ashes, but more so in lost potential. We need to provide enough oxygen so that there's heat being generated to drive that gas out of the wood, but we don't want to provide so much that the gases are combusting right away as soon as they're driven out. We want to treat these gases carefully, and there's a few steps in that process. The first being drying out that fuel, We need to make sure the moisture level is low enough, heating that wood up to around 100 degrees Celsius, and that's where you'll see that moisture turning into steam and being driven out of the fuel. From there, we're furthering that pyrolysis process by heating that wood up to around 240 Celsius is when you'll start to see real action. That's where you start to see the production of tars as smoke. And the gases, you'll see carbon monoxide, you'll see carbon dioxide, you'll see hydrogen, all of those things being produced. And if you don't treat those gases correctly, their potential leaves unrealized. And if you treat those gases properly, methodically, carefully, you can get a lot of energy out of that piece of wood. And you can use that moisture, you can use those gases that are being released to help break down the rest of that piece of wood. You can break down the coal, the carbon, and you can do it in a process that generates very, very little emissions as the end result. An awful lot of heat, very, very few emissions. Somebody who's considering heating their home with wood, what are some of the things that are important to you?
I would say being able to get the biggest bang for my buck. One likes to be out in the bush cutting wood and whatever, but you don't want to have that be your full-time job. So you want to try to get as much length out of your wood burning as possible, be it being able to use the extra gases or whatever would be the best to be able to get the longest amount of burn for the least amount of fuel being needed.
Yeah, and if you knew that there was a way to generate more heat out of that same piece of firewood, you'd probably
definitely
have some
it.
Interest.
Very, very much so. Yeah, you bet.
Yeah, and how important do you see clean burning being to somebody in your situation? Would it bother you to have a lot of smoke coming off of a furnace?
Being on a farmyard and not having any close neighbors, it wouldn't be a huge deal, but obviously, depending on the wind direction, I know that if we're, let's say, burning garbage in the yard, you don't want all that smoke happen to be coming towards the house.
Sure.
And so, yeah, this would be probably similar in the fact that, yeah, if the wind is wrong, you're going to have all this smoke coming right back into towards your house. And if you happen to have your windows open, yeah, it definitely wouldn't be a good thing.
Yeah. How do you see that if you picture that smoke as lost potential?
Yeah, that's the other part. If I would see all that smoke going out, then, well, it'd be like burning money. It's you can't get that back. So it's, that would be very unfortunate to see all that potential savings, I guess, especially if you knew that there is some technology out there that you'd be able to utilize all that smoke, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. That's just part of the process. That's a huge driving factor. We don't want to waste anything. We know how much energy goes into growing the wood, processing the wood, drying the wood, loading the furnace. It's a discipline that people are putting effort into doing.
Yeah.
And we want to try to respect that and use it to the fullest extent. Albert, great to sit down and chat a bit about gasification and what we've learned in our design time at HeatMaster. What have you all learned in the last while on gasification in our development?
Breaking apart the separate aspects of combustion, clean combustion, what it takes to control it, separate it, and in the end to manufacture a product that gives us the end result that we're looking for, which is clean combustion.
What kinds of things have we experienced and encountered, challenges we've faced in developing a good, clean gasifying product?
We found that optimum fuel is very important, and both over-dried wood and or wood that's too wet is less than desirable. The perfect kiln-dried wood gives us the best results.
Yeah, I found that very interesting in the times where we would gasify with over-dried wood. I'm talking about wood that's less than 15% moisture. that combustion is happening so fast, the gas is being generated so fast, that it's sometimes a challenge to manage it through the combustion side of the process. And the flip side of that would be that when there's so much moisture, so much water present in the combustion chamber, how that hinders that whole gasification process. It's quenching the gasification process and hindering the full efficiency of the burn. The energy it takes to drive that water out of that wood is consuming so much of that usable heat that you're left with much less heat than what you would like out of that piece of wood.
And although the furnace is capable of burning either woods, you just, the end result isn't what you want. You end up going through a lot more fuel and putting a lot less energy into your home. You're putting a lot more out the chimney.
Exactly. Yeah, to be capable of doing it is one thing, but to be able to do it in a desirable way where the outcome is low emissions, high efficiency, great heat output, and long burn times, those are all things that are important to us at HeatMaster, is making a furnace that's low maintenance and low fuel requirements or minimal fuel requirements, maximizing the extraction of BTUs out of each piece of wood and ending up with a furnace that's requiring very little maintenance from the customer.
Right.
And that's something that we've seen from different angles. Let's shift gears and go to the first step in the process, that paralysis where we're making that wood gas. What have we all seen there in relation to firebox environment? What do we need to be able to generate wood gas effectively?
Being able to control the combustion in the firebox is of great importance, so controlling our air intake. Again, if you have the correct moisture content in your wood, the furnace has the capability of controlling the over air, the top air, in the way that is needed to obtain good pyrolysis, good wood gas production, which in the end allows us to burn cleanly down in the hot zone, the refractory.
Yeah, we've also seen incredible importance in the coal bed itself. Putting wood into a cold furnace, for example, where there's been no fire and you're loading this up with raw wood, the furnace will never perform properly until there's a significant bed of coals at the bottom of that firebox. And those coals are the driving force behind making gasification effective. We can generate wood gas, but if we don't have that superheated coal bed to drive that gas through, we can't realize the full benefit of that gasification process. We aren't converting the gases to something volatile if we don't have that superheated coal bed. And that's something that we've taken a lot of time and care to ensure that the air coming into that upper firebox is placed well and managed well. If we put in too much air, we're combusting in the upper firebox before we're sending that air through the heated coal bed. If we are putting that air in too high or too low, it makes a difference. If we don't control our velocities in our mixing, our combustion process after the superheated coal bed is not as effective. Tell us a little bit about our experiues in driving flue gas through the superheated coal bed and where it goes after that. How can we best utilize this superheated gas leaving that coal bed?
As the wood gas is pulled through the coal bed, and the coal bed almost acts as a filter, cleaning up the wood gas, we're pulling it through our refractory burn slot and injecting secondary air at that point, preheated secondary air, which allows us to combust in our lower refractory, in our turbulent zone, promoting good wood gas / fresh oxygen mixing, and then promoting a clean burn.
You could also add the benefit of sending that wood gas and moisture through that coal bed. That coal bed is acting as a bit of a catalyst in driving good usage of oxygen. That oxygen is being used to further break down that coal bed and drive that carbon into a gas that we can combust in that lower chamber. It's acting as the source of heat for the initial pyrolysis, and it's also acting as a catalyst for good combustion in that lower chamber. And I mean, our users, our customers operating furnaces will see that you don't get effective gasification without a good coal bed. And so that's a byproduct of good wood, dry wood, and controlled combustion. And we put a lot of effort and energy into creating that ideal environment for all of those things to be happening reliably, efficiently, for a long time. Durability of those components, using the right materials for the job, so that this is not a high maintenance piece of equipment. It's simple for the user to operate and reliable and very effective in extracting every ounce of energy from that fuel. It's been interesting, since gasification has caught fire, pardon the pun, in the industry, it's been taking root. It's been overtaking the non-gasification equipment in the marketplace by leaps and bounds. It's something that people had to wrap their minds around originally. The product also had to develop along with the concept of gasifying. We had to be able to design better equipment to carry out this process. We had to have equipment that could do this with some flexibility, with reliable components that are not requiring high maintenance and special procedures and fancy tools. We wanted this to be something that anybody could do. Anyone can operate a modern gasification furnace. At HeatMasterss, that's incredibly important to us. Our furnaces are more forgiving today than they've ever been. With that said, we still want every ounce of energy and every ounce of potential out of that wood to be in the water. We don't want to lose that in drying wood in the firebox. So it's still an important factor, but more forgiving, more user-friendly, less maintenance, easier to clean these furnaces. The days of scraping creosote off of heat exchangers are gone. We can burn clean, we can burn dry, and we want to see that only improve going forward, to be able to do it as energy efficient and environmentally conscious as possible.